Give us some men who know the truth.
I just stood up here and talked about bras. Anyway.
What's wrong with you people?
What is Jesus Jeopardy? Jesus was playing a little game, and he said, who do other people say that I am?
And who will declare the truth?
Now this is called the Drenchinator. You see it?
Hey, baby. I'm my hunger in my head.
You want to know how that one man dying alone for a few short hours on a tree can save a multitude of men from an eternity in hell? Because that one man is worth more than all of them put together.
We gotta read some scripture to make this.
And who will stand with Athanasius and Polycarp and Calvin and Luther and Whitfield and Edwards? And who will declare from the housetops that the gospel is the power of God unto salvation?
Good morning, and welcome to the threshing floor. What is the threshing floor? Well, I'm glad you asked.
I didn't ask.
It was a rhetorical question.
I wish I had those miracle smart pills.
The threshing floor is where we take two sermons on the same passage of Scripture and compare them to the Scripture they both claim to be exegeting. That is the bar we are using, the Bible, the canon. That's what the word canon means, by the way, a standard, or you might say a ruler. This is not our own personal opinions or taste. This is not a critique of style or delivery. We are comparing what is being said with what God has said, as the Bereans were called noble for doing of the Apostle Paul in Acts chapter 17.
Let's do this. Hear now the words of the living and the true God. And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah, talking with him. And Peter said to Jesus, Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make three tents here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. He was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, this is my beloved son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. When the disciples heard this, they fell on their faces and were terrified. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, rise and have no fear. And when they lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. And as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus commanded them, tell no one the vision until the Son of Man is raised from the dead. And the disciples asked him, then, why do the scribes say that first Elijah must come? He answered, Elijah does come, and he will restore all things. But I tell you that Elijah has already come. And they did not recognize him, but did to him whatever they pleased. So also the Son of Man will certainly suffer at their hands. Then the disciples understood that he was speaking to them of John the Baptist.
I've noticed that people on an airplane and people in a church service have much in common. Most are well-behaved and presentable. All are on a journey. Some tend to doze. And the measure of a successful flight for many and the measure of a successful church service for many is the same, and that is nice. How was your flight? Oh, it was nice. We like to be able to say that. How was your worship service? Oh, it was nice. It was nice.
So Matthew chapter 17, Jesus now has told his people that some of them standing here will not taste death until they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. So you see this really throughout the New Testament. You see it quite a lot, actually, and it causes no small controversy amongst Christians in terms of how do you manage that? How do you manage the fact that Jesus did teach, the Bible does teach, that Jesus was going to return in that generation before they all had died? You see it in particular a lot through the gospel according to Matthew, this emphasis upon this impending judgment upon that first century generation. Your Bible, Matthew, kicks off Matthew chapter 3 with Elijah, John the Baptist, coming in, first words out of his mouth, Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent, for the kingdom of God. The rule of God is at the fingertip reach. It's right there at the reach. It's here now. Repent, turn, have a change of mind. God's rule is now breaking into history. That's chapter 3 of Matthew. Matthew is, of course, doing that on purpose. He knows the entirety of the story, and so he's bringing the story together for us. This was the Elijah that we expected. If you look in your Old Testament, right before Matthew opens up, you can see it. So just do that. Keep one finger here in Matthew. Just move over to your Old Testament where it ends. You have that little white piece of paper there. That's the intertestamental period. And I want you just to see it now. Malachi, we have it now in order at the last of the Old Testament prophets. Look at Malachi, and you see in chapter 3 and in chapter 4, this discussion of Elijah.
And since most of us are looking for a nice flight or a nice worship service, the word fits. For some, however, it does not. It did not fit for that little fella I saw some time ago on a flight. I had already taken my seat on the plane. The little guy might have been 6 or 7 years of age. He boarded the plane and he announced with a question this: "Can I meet the pilot?" Either he was shrewd or lucky, because he knew exactly where to stand and ask that question. He had just boarded, and so the question floated into the cockpit. It wasn't 15 seconds before a head popped out. "Did I hear someone call me?" And the little boy's hand went up like it might have gone up in a response to a second grade teacher's class. "I did." "Well, come on in," the pilot said. And next thing that boy knew, he was in the cockpit, exposed to the world of gauges and levers and gears. And he came out with a smile wider than a watermelon slice and wearing some plastic wings. I was jealous. And I realized, he's the happiest kid on the plane, happiest person on the plane. I know that because he said so. To his mom, as he walked past, he said, "I'm so happy. I'm so happy." Piqued my interest. I began looking at other people's faces. They didn't look happy. Well, a couple of them looked pretty cranky. And a couple of ladies were giddy. But most people were just content. Content to be out of the airport, content to be on a leg closer to their destination, content. Content and expecting to have a nice flight. They were content.
This messenger who's coming before the Messiah himself. Just look at chapter 3 of Malachi, just briefly. "Behold, I send my messenger," verse 1, "and he will prepare the way before me, and the Lord," check that out, "and the Lord whom you seek," this is the one we're waiting for, "the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. And the messenger of the covenant in whom you delight, behold, he's coming, says the Lord of hosts." That's chapter 3 of Malachi. You're ending your Old Testament. You've got Elijah who's coming first, then the Lord whom you seek is coming to, listen to the words, his temple. That's what they expected. And you have, of course, a description in Malachi 3, we've read it before, of the twofold nature of the coming of Messiah. It's going to be, one, purification and salvation for God's people, and two, it's going to be judgment upon the covenant breakers. So this is the timeline they were accustomed to. Elijah comes first, and then the Messiah comes to his very temple. It's a twofold nature. It is, one, judgment, two, purification and salvation. These things are all wrapped up in the coming of the kingdom of God in history. In Malachi chapter 4, look there, verse 1. "Behold, the day is coming, burning like an oven, when all the arrogant and all evildoers will be stubble. The day is coming that shall set them ablaze, says the Lord of hosts, so that it will leave them neither root nor branch. But for you," look, see, twofold again, judgment. "But for you who fear my name, the Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing in its wings." Did you catch it? twofold nature of the coming of Messiah, the messenger, the forerunner, Jesus, and then there's going to be judgment and salvation.
I've noticed, as I get to speak at a lot of churches all around the world, that most people show up content, really content. Yeah, very happy to be here. Very happy to leave the way they came in. Content. Every so often, however, every so often, somebody shows up like that little boy. They show up, they walk onto the church property, they enter a church sanctuary, and they have this look in their eyes. I want to see the one in charge. I want to see the pilot. I want to see the one who flies, who's sovereign, who oversees, who's at the controls. I want to see him. I want to know him. I want to hear him. I want to sense him. I want to learn more about him. And since Jesus said, seek and you will find, what we seek is usually what we find. And if somebody seeks just to be content, that's usually what they find. But when those come seeking to have an encounter with the pilot, they often leave with a set of wings. Such happened to Jesus on the day he went to worship. It may surprise you to think of Jesus at a worship service. Yet if we understand that a worship service is simply a congregation of people who are seeking God to stand in his presence, what happened on the Mount of Transfiguration then qualifies as a worship service. Jesus took his three of his apostles, Peter, James, and John, and they ascended a mountain for the simple and singular purpose of standing in the presence of God. It's in Matthew chapter 17.
And now enter Jesus in the text before us. Matthew chapter 17, you see Jesus going up to the transfiguration. But before that, you have that consistency with the Old Testament revelation. Jesus is going to judge the covenant breakers. The kingdom of God is going to break into history. Some of you will not die until you see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. Again, all of this consistent with the Old Testament revelation. What did they know about the Son of Man? Well, they knew Daniel. Daniel chapter 7, verses 13 through 14. Daniel's night visions, one like a Son of Man, comes up to the Ancient of Days. He's presented before him, and to him, the Son of Man, is given dominion, glory, and a kingdom that all the peoples, nations, men of every language might serve him. His dominion is an everlasting, eternal dominion. It'll never pass away. His kingdom, his rule, will never be destroyed. And isn't it amazing? In Matthew 16, Jesus just told Peter, what? About his kingdom. He says, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. That's consistent with that Old Testament revelation. This is the Messiah that they expected. Although there were certain things about Jesus coming that they just couldn't understand. What do you mean you're going to die? What do you mean you're going to rise again? Peter's trying to tell Jesus it'll never happen. And Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. What's amazing is it wasn't that the Old Testament revelation didn't tell them this. It was that it was so glorious, huge, complex, and perfect and amazing, they couldn't have possibly understood it all.
This is the Sunday that celebrates the triumphant entry of Christ into Jerusalem. And the people receive Jesus by worshiping him. This is also the Sunday that brings to a close our conversation under the theme Overflow, looking at worship. And so what a great intersection. Here we're talking about worship on the very Sunday that we celebrate the way Christ was worshiped as he entered Jerusalem. And when we think about worship, often we have a few questions. Why do we worship? How do we worship? Whom do we worship? I think we can find some answers to those questions under the headings of three different words. One of those words is transformation. The other word that we're going to look at is proclamation. And then the third word is preparation.
Which makes Jesus and his earthly ministry so powerful. Why? Because if you read in the Gospels, John chapter 1 in particular, where it gives you this revelation of who Jesus is, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. It says that all things came into being through him, and without him, nothing came into being that's come into being. And it says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory. And then it tells us that grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. It's a powerful testimony in John chapter 1. I want you to see it. Keep your finger there in Matthew just to get an explanation of just what is happening here in Matthew 16 and 17. So finger here in Matthew 17 and move to John. Over to your right, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Very, very interesting gospel. Different than the synoptics. Different than the first three in many respects. But I want you to see it, because it goes along with everything happening here in Matthew 17 in terms of this. Watch. The Father says to the disciples, this is the Son of my love. I love him. I am pleased with him. Listen to him. In John chapter 1, John gives that same story, same thing. It says in verse 14, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness about him and cried out. That's John the Baptist. John bore witness about him and cried out, this was he of whom I said, he who comes after me, watch, here it is, ranks before me because he was before me. And from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, the only God who is at the Father's side. Did you catch that? The only God, Jesus, who is in the bosom of the Father. He has made him known. The Greek words there behind that, he has made him known, are essentially the same thing we talk about when we talk about exegesis. What's that? What's that mean? Drawing out of the text. What does it mean, right? God's word speaks and we draw out of the text. We don't add our stuff into the text and eisegete the text. We have it explained to us, draw out. So in this text here, we see that John says, he ranks before me because he was before me. He is Jesus, grace upon grace. And he says what? He says he's at the Father's side, and he, Jesus, has explained the Father to us. Jesus, watch, exegetes the Father.
So transformation, proclamation, and preparation. Are you ready? Transformation. When Jesus went upon the Mount of Transfiguration, his face was transformed. The second verse says his face became bright like the sun. Isn't that interesting? You know, our face is the most visible part of our bodies. And our face is what demonstrates what emotion we're carrying, right? If I want to see if you're in a good mood, I don't look at your elbow. I look at your face. Our face is what we remember about somebody. When you look at a high school annual, you don't see pictures of people's feet, hopefully. You see pictures of their faces, because that's what we remember. So I take from this that when someone worships God, God changes their face.
He exegetes the Father to his people. He explains, this is what the Father is like. Just consider for a second. Moses, prophet, amazing prophet of God. Wow. All of us, if we have to confess, if he walked in this room today, we would probably be so in awe. We'd probably do the same, kind of fall to our knees saying, let's build a tent, let's do something to like commemorate this moment of Moses or Elijah or David or Isaiah or Jeremiah. These are amazing prophets of God, but you know what they're not? They're nothing like Jesus. Ultimately, they're foreshadows of Jesus and what he is as perfect prophet, priest, and king, but they are nothing like Jesus. They can't explain the Father like Jesus. Why? This gets to everything that's in Matthew chapter 17. The Father says, listen to him. I want you to listen to my son. Let him be the foundation through which you view everything else. Stop focusing in upon Moses as supreme revelation and Elijah, the law and the prophets. If you want to know what the law and prophets are, you listen to my son. How do you know my son is trustworthy? Why? Because he is in the bosom of the Father. In archein ho logos. Kai ho logos ein proston theon. Kai theos ein ho logos. John chapter 1 in Greek. As far back as you want to go forever with no stopping. Jesus, he's already there.
He changes their face. We don't change our face. We don't need to force some fake smile or create some odd hypocritical religious look. But as we behold the face of God, he changes our face. In fact, we could say God wants us to see his face so he can change ours. God wants to wipe away those wrinkles of worry. God wants to remove those bags beneath our eyes of fatigue. God wants to put a smile where there was a frown. He wants to put peace where there was anger. He wants to change our face. He wants to change our hearts. And the overflow of that is a changed face.
He was already there. He is proston theon, toward the Father, face to face with the Father, in intimate relationship with the Father, and he is fully God. You want to know the Father? You listen to the one who has been in intimate fellowship with the Father from all eternity. And I wanted to say this. This isn't something we could possibly grasp. There's no way you can comprehend it. Try. You can't. Our 3-pound creaturely brains cannot fathom and understand, comprehend fully the glory of the Trinity, the fellowship between Father and Son. Jesus knows the Father perfectly. And so when they go up to this high mountain for the transfiguration, they get just a blip, just a moment where they actually see the tear in the physical. The physical world is split for just a moment, just a glimpse, just a small taste of what Jesus, who Jesus actually is. Earth, space, time splits, and they get a glimpse of who they have been walking with, the transfiguration. And what does the Father want his people to do? Not to build a tabernacle for Moses and Elijah and memorialize them ultimately. You have my son, the son of my love, the one that I am pleased with. Listen to him.
And that happens as we stand in the presence of God. The Apostle Paul wrote, our faces then are not covered. We all show the Lord's glory because we are being changed to be like him. This change in us brings ever greater glory, which comes from the Lord. So we stand before the Lord in worship, private worship during the week, and corporate or congregational worship on Saturday night or Sunday morning. And something happens to us. The psalmist or shepherd or king, David, all three, right? He gave a great definition of worship. He said, oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. Have you ever looked through a magnifying glass at something? What happens when you look through a magnifying glass? The object you're looking at appears what?
Larger.
It doesn't actually grow, but it appears larger. Well, worship does that. Worship magnifies the Lord. Worship steps into the cockpit and says, I want to see more of you, Lord. I want to see your face. I want to see your heart. I want to understand your hands. I want to understand what you're doing. Oh, magnify. So David is saying, let's all come together and magnify the Lord. Let's make him big. Not that he is bigger, because he cannot be bigger than he already is, but that our vision of him can increase. We can have a bigger view of him. And we need a big view of God because we have big problems in life.
You see, what's important for us to get is this about the scriptures, and it's going to come back always at Apologia Church. We're always going to talk about this. The Old Testament, glorious revelation of God, still, contrary to popular preachers of today, still relevant
today, still true today, still to be appealed to today. Still and always, it is the Word of God and it is always true. However, when you look at the Old Testament revelation, what you're looking at is the beginning of this grand revelation of God, this potent revelation of God. You have Moses, a prophet who speaks with God on a high mountain with the glory cloud of God, receiving stone tablets from God to reveal to the people of God. The law of God, which could not save anybody, but the law of God, which is good, which God says in Deuteronomy 4, was supposed to be their wisdom in the sight of the peoples. People were supposed to see the law of God given from Moses to the people of God, not as a curse, but as their wisdom. People were supposed to see the law of God and they're supposed to say, my goodness, what nation is there that has a God so near to them as the Israelites? And what nation is there that has laws, justice, statutes, so wise and perfect as this law?
We have big challenges and we have big questions and we have big worries. And the way we deal with those big issues is we worship. We get a bigger view of God. We might think that there would be something more complicated than enlarging God, but that's really what the scripture says. Worship is the act of enlarging God, to stand before God and let Him change us as we stand before Him. Please note that Jesus was changed through worship. The scripture doesn't say Jesus changed His face. Again, so it's not up to us to change the way we look, but God will change our appearance through worship.
However, the thing is, you still have the problem of sin. The people of God are still in sin. The people of God haven't experienced what you and I have today, the resurrection that we have today, being made alive with Jesus, joined together with Him in His death and His resurrection. They haven't experienced the outpouring of the Spirit of God. They have Moses. They have word from God. That's a blessing. But they still have something else. What do they have? Physical temple. It's a temple that somebody can knock down, and it was knocked down in history, destroyed, set on fire, gold melting between the cracks. It's taken down. They have a city that can be destroyed, not a heavenly city yet, a temple that can be taken down. They have a priest who's a sinner who has to offer sacrifices for himself first. They have prophets of God, priests from God, but these guys come and they go. They live and they die. Yom Kippur is the Day of Atonement. And when does it happen? Yom Kippur, annually, every year. It's a reminder, this isn't done. This isn't okay. We're not right. How do I know? Because you know what? There's a holiest place that I can't even enter. And God builds this sanctuary to display what? A ritual to remind us. God, watch this. Here's what's important. Watch. The temple and the Holy of Holies? What? Heaven. Heaven itself can't contain God. Did you get that? Heaven itself can't contain God. God isn't stuck in the holiest place in the Old Testament. He's not hanging out there, not able to escape. It's a ritual. It is a walking through a sign. The priest is going in before the people of God to represent them before God, and he's going before a veil that blocks them from the holiest place. It's supposed to shout to God's people, it's not done. There's something between you and I. It's not as though our God is contained in this perfect box-shaped room. It's not as though the animal sacrifice is taking away any sin. The blood of bulls and goats could never take away sin, and they knew it. Why? That thing is an image of God. That goat, the scapegoat, is not the image of God. That thing they're leading away from the people of God to watch their sins depart from them as far as the east is from the west, that's not image of God. That animal dying without spot and blemish is still not image of God. This is all patterns. It's all dress rehearsals. It's all rituals to do what? To testify about something far superior and more beautiful and more eternal.
He changes us. There's a moment of transformation. But here's something else. Worship is more than transformation. Worship is proclamation. Proclamation. When the Apostle Paul described the act of communion, which is one of the acts of worship, look what he said. As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you what? What's the word? You proclaim. You proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So every time you receive communion, you are issuing a proclamation. You know what that proclamation is? I still believe. It's been a hard week, but I still believe. I'm battling an illness or a disease, but you know what? I still believe. The world seems crazy, but I still believe. And to whom are you making this proclamation? Well, you're making this proclamation to your family, perhaps, who sit around you, to your husband, to your wife, to your kids, to your parents. I'm still believing. I'm still believing. To your fellow congregants, we still believe. We still believe. To people you don't know, when they see you participate, you're saying, I still believe. To a cynical world, a sour world, you're saying, oh no, I still believe. To those saints who have gone ahead, that great cloud of witnesses that are watching down upon us, to the grandmother who prayed for you, to your parents who took you to church, to the neighbor who loved you but has gone into heaven, to them you're saying, I still believe. Even to God himself, or especially to God himself.
Because what do you have now in Jesus, the perfect prophet? What do you have now in Jesus, the perfect priest? What do you have now in Jesus? You have what the forerunner, Elijah, John the Baptist, said of him. What happened when they first introduced Jesus and John the Baptist testifies as a matter of history about who it is that they're dealing with? He says, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is what we are waiting for. Just consider it. Moses, amazing prophet of God. Elijah, representing the prophets, amazing prophet of God. Elijah's the man. He's the bomb. He is, seriously. If Elijah had a church today, you should go to his church because he's the man. He really is. But you know what's amazing about these two prophets? All they could do is lay down the rudimentary things. Because what? Jesus, who's in the bosom of the Father, hasn't come yet. He's not there yet. All they can do is give you the ritual, the symbol, and it is so rich. Just consider Moses for a second. What did Moses tell him to do? Moses says, get a lamb, no spot, no blemish. They don't know why. All they know is God says, and I do. That's it. He says, I do. I don't know why. He says, get a lamb, no spot, no blemish. Got it. Check. Lamb, no spot, no blemish. By the way, don't break its bones. Okay? Don't break its bones. No spot, no blemish, check. Don't break its bones, check. Then take the blood of the lamb, no spot, no blemish. You haven't broken its bones? Haven't broken its bones. Okay, take the blood of that lamb now and you put it over your doorposts. Put the blood of the lamb over your doorposts. And then when my judgment comes, I will pass over that house on account of the lamb with no spot and no blemish, no broken bones, and you'll then be freed from your slavery in Egypt to enter into the promised land with God. They don't know why. It's a beautiful thing. Moses said to do it, and so they did it. But here's the thing. That wasn't the thing. That wasn't the substance. It was only pointing to the greater reality of what we have in Jesus. Jesus, the Lamb of God, with no sin, no stain, no deceit in his mouth, as Isaiah 53 says. And he dies when in history? On Passover. And when he was on that cross, the Roman guards broke the legs of the criminals with Jesus. They broke their bones, but they come to Jesus and they did not break his bones on Passover. And then at Passover, that blood was spilled for the people of God. So that as we come near to Jesus and trust in the one who's in the bosom of the Father, his blood covers us and the judgment of God passes over us.
You're saying, Lord, I know I'm not perfect and I could have done better this week, but here I am. I still believe. I'm proclaiming the Lord's death until he comes. I'm proclaiming the power of the death, the burial and the resurrection of Christ over my life. I receive his grace. I stand in his power. I accept his forgiveness. I proclaim his death. But do you know to whom else you are making this proclamation? You are proclaiming this to the devil. To the devil. There is a devil. There are demons. There are spiritual forces. Every battle in life is first a spiritual battle. Every battle in life is a spiritual battle. And when you worship, you're telling Satan, get out of here. Here's a passage from the book of James. You're going to love this, especially this translation from James chapter 4, verses 7 and 8. So let God work his will in you. Yell aloud, no to the devil, and watch him scamper. Say a quiet yes to God, and he'll be there in no time. Isn't that a great verse?
We are redeemed, pulled out of our slavery to sin, to enter into the promised land of relationship with God. We have a heavenly city which can never be destroyed. We have a temple in the heavens, Jesus. All of us are little stones, Peter says, being built up into the house of God. We have a priest now forever in the heavens who intercedes for us. Right now, he's praying for you. Right now, he's interceding on your behalf. We have a priest now who lives in the heavens forever, who has taken his seat on that throne after he split that veil. Never forget that on the day of the atonement, the eternal once for all atonement, that veil split. It tore. Signifying what? That now it's finished. It is finished. Now we can enter into that holiest of holies. We enter into the presence of God himself now with bold and confident access. Why? Because we have Jesus.
Yell aloud no to the devil. You want to give the devil a no? 1, 2, 3.
No!
And yell a quiet, or give a quiet yes to the Lord, and he'll be there in no time. 1, 2, 3. Yes. Worship is yelling no to the devil and saying yes to God. It's that simple. You see, Satan will not long linger where God is praised. He hates our worship. It makes him puke. We know this because the whole reason he was cast out of heaven to begin with is that he wanted to be worshiped. He wanted to take God's place. And since no one is worthy of worship except God, Satan was cast out. But I tell you what, he's not only a fallen angel, he's a dumb angel. Because he's still trying to get people to worship him. And sadly, he succeeds. A lot of people worship the works of the devil. But when you worship, when you gather with a congregation, or when you take private time in your home or in your commute or wherever you are, when you worship, then you're saying yes to God. And Satan doesn't say. He says, okay, I'm giving up on that one. I'm moving over to some house where they don't do that. So if you want Satan to leave your house, turn your house into a house of worship. You want Satan to leave your cubicle, turn your little cubicle into a place of worship. You want Satan to leave that hotel room alone, then walk into that hotel room with earbuds or praise music or scriptures. Bless that room with worship. You see, worship is war.
It's finished. It's over. Now, I lay all that down to say, when we understand the purpose of the pattern fulfillments of the Old Testament, we can fully understand this moment of the Transfiguration where Moses and Elijah, representing the law and the prophets, show up next to Jesus and are conversing with him. How crazy would that? That must have been nuts. You can definitely sympathize with the apostles there on this high mountain, seeing this amazing split between heaven and earth open now, and the glory of the true Jesus just shine through. Not trying to disassemble Jesus and his humanity and divinity, but you get my point. You see the glory of who he truly is just shine through for that moment. You can get for a moment why the apostles are like, let's build tabernacles here. Let's build some memorials on this mountain for the law and the prophets and Jesus. And right as they're speaking, the Father speaks from heaven.
In fact, kind of my new phrase is, instead of saying, let's go to church, I tell Dylan, I say, okay, honey, time to go to war. Because it's warfare. Yeah, it's pleasant. Oh, it's wonderful. Yes, it's upbuilding. But it's also spiritual warfare. Because we're fighting against the forces of evil. We're telling the devil to leave this part of the world alone. Leave this house alone. Leave this society alone. And he cannot resist it because he hates worship. And that's why worship, by the way, is sometimes so difficult to do. You don't have to raise your hand, but was it hard for you to get here today? Do you ever find it difficult? You'd think it'd be pretty easy, you know, get everybody up, get them dressed, get in the car. But I have found through the years that sometimes just getting to church is hard. And that's okay. But now you know why. Satan's trying to trip us up. And I've noticed through the years that congregations get into arguments about worship more than any other thing. And that is because when Satan cannot distract us from worshiping, he'll want to divide us about worshiping. And then he'll, you know, we won't worship. His whole goal is to interrupt this. Let it be said loudly. Worship is not entertainment. A worship is not a warm-up for the sermon. Worship is an act of war against the devil. We know this because of stories like the one found in 2 Chronicles chapter 20. The story of a king, a 35-year-old king by the name of Jehoshaphat. Some say Jehoshaphat. I don't care. I like that name though. Jehoshaphat. I wish my mom had named me Jehoshaphat. Isn't that a great name? Kind of a unique name. Jehoshaphat. He became king when he was 35 years of age. Soon after he ascended to the throne, an alliance of three different armies came after him. It was tough enough fighting one army, but then two and then three, they all joined forces together. And he knew he was outnumbered and outmaneuvered. And so he did what God wants us to do. He went to God in prayer. 2 Chronicles chapter 20 and verse 3. He set himself to seek the Lord. Then he proclaimed a fast throughout all Judah. He cried out to the Lord in prayer. He confessed, "We have no power, nor do we know what to do, but our eyes are upon you." Isn't that a great prayer? I don't know what to do. I don't have any power, but I'm looking at you, Lord. I'm not giving up. God responded with this message. "Do not be afraid nor dismayed because of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's."
Doesn't happen all the time. It's actually a rare instance, pretty rare in history, where the Father speaks from heaven like this. You have it where else? Where else do you have in Jesus' ministry where the Father speaks from heaven? Where else? The baptism of Jesus. John the Baptist, the forerunner, is anointing Jesus as priest. Jesus isn't repenting of sin and being baptized. John's the son of a priest. He's a priest. He's anointing Jesus for his ministry. It gave Jesus the right as priest to be able to cleanse the temple and do what he did. But notice the Father spoke from heaven then too. He said, "This is my son in whom I am well pleased." That's the Father speaking. And another moment here, Moses, law and prophets, Elijah and Jesus. Let's build some memorials here for these prophets. And the Father says, "No, this is my son. This is the son of my love. You listen to him." What's that saying? It's to say that all of us are supposed to now filter all of the word of God. Everything, not going one direction from the old to the new, but we're supposed to see Jesus standing in the new covenant as the supreme revelation at the top of the mountain through which everything else is viewed.
Jehoshaphat so firmly believed this in his heart, you're not going to believe what he did. If you already know, don't tell anybody. I want to tell them. You're not going to believe what he did. He took his singers, the equivalent of his worshipers, his worship band, if you will. And he put them in front of his soldiers, and he told his singers, he said, lead the way into battle. And so all those brawny soldiers with their shields and their swords, they had to step back, and here come the worshipers. They led the way into battle. I bet those choir members didn't sign up for that part. But they did. And I can just envision them singing songs of praise, singing songs of worship, lifting up their hands, declaring that God is God, this battle is the Lord's. And you know what happened? When they got to the battlefield, they found out that all three armies were already destroyed. They had turned on each other. And when they got there, they didn't have to do anything. The battle was already won. By the way, our singers, our 120 voice singers, they call themselves not the choir, but the singers because of 2 Chronicles chapter 20. The singers led the way into battle. Let's do this, shall we? In our own lives, let's lead with worship. Let's lead with worship. Let's realize it is warfare. That worship is warfare. And it's a war that we will win. We lead with worship, because it is a proclamation. And then one final point, I got to move really quickly, and that is the word preparation. Preparation.
How are you supposed to view the law and the prophets now? You view them through the lens of Jesus. See, here's the thing. Oftentimes as Christians, we blow this. There are communions that blow this completely. There are many examples that can be displayed happening today on this day in history where there are people who profess faith in Jesus and they're reading it all like Peter wanted to do. Let's put Jesus here in the long line of law and prophets and let's try to view them together, maybe even in order from Moses through. Let's try to interpret it backwards from Moses to Jesus. But the Father says, no. You would now look to my son and you listen to him. Jesus is the full and final revelation of God himself. You listen to him.
When Jesus went up on the Mount of Transfiguration, that moment presupposes some preparation. He had to say, okay, this is my priority. I don't think he woke up one morning and said, good day to go up the mountain. He selected Peter, James, and John. They went on a long walk up the mountain. They had to take supplies. He had to get out ahead of it and clear the calendar. It was a priority to him. Can I urge you to make worship a priority to you?
How are you to view the law of God now today in the new covenant? Through Jesus. How are you to view the prophets of the Old Testament? Through Jesus. He's the supreme revelation. Now, I want to just take you to a really quick point. It's powerful. It's amazing because Matthew's doing it a lot. He's doing it a lot here in this gospel. Do you notice, and I don't want to go over it again, but do you guys remember we spent time when we were in Matthew chapter 1 and 2 showing you that Matthew is actually trying to display that Jesus is what all those things were prefigures of. So, for example, Jesus is a baby, and you have this story of a political ruler who tries to kill Jesus as a baby, and he narrowly escapes. What's that sound like? Who did that happen to in the Old Testament? Moses. Same thing. You have Jesus being led by the Spirit of God into the wilderness for 40 days. You have the whole, I know what that means, Israel in the wilderness, wandering. But see, Jesus, as the true and perfect Israelite, goes through the wilderness wandering, and the trials that happen there, he accomplishes what Adam failed in and Israel failed in. Adam was to be God's light in the world. He failed. He disobeyed God. Israel was to be God's light in the world. He failed. They failed and disobeyed God. You see, Matthew is showing you that Jesus is what all of that was supposed to be.
How do you do when it comes to preparation for worship? I have a hunch that many of us might just kind of wake up and show up. But what if you made preparation? What do you mean, Max? Well, what if you spent a few moments in prayer before you got here so your heart would be prayerful when you arrive? Well, what if you spent a few moments reading scriptures to your family so that when you show up, the scripture doesn't sound foreign. I'm very sympathetic, families. I raised three daughters. My wife and I raised three daughters. And she did a lot of the work because I was preaching. I know how chaotic and difficult it can be getting the family to church. I get that. So don't beat yourself up. But give it a go. Give it a go. Try to get a good night's sleep on Saturday so you're not sleepy on Sunday. And just say, Lord, I'm excited. I'm excited to be here.
Now, in this text, did you know it's not isolated? That this happened before in history? What happens here? Some of you won't die. And then there's this experience 6 days later where Jesus takes Peter, James, and John, his brother, and leads them up to a high mountain. And he was, verse 2, transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to him Moses and Elijah talking with him. Now watch, if you take your finger, keep it there in Matthew, and just move back to the beginning of your Bibles now. Go to Exodus 24. Exodus 24. Here's the law. Exodus 24, starting in verse 1. So you have your Pentateuch, the five books of Moses. We refer to that as the law of God. The Jews refer to it as the law. First five books of Moses. Check this out. Chapter 24, in verse 1. Then he said to Moses, come up to the Lord, you and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and worship from afar. Moses alone shall come near to the Lord, but the others shall not come near, and the people shall not come up with him. Moses came and told the people all the words of the Lord and all the rules, and all the people answered with one voice and said, all the words that the Lord has spoken we will do. And Moses wrote down all the words of the Lord. He rose early in the morning and built an altar at the foot of the mountain, and 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of Israel. And he sent young men of the people of Israel who offered burnt offerings and sacrificed peace offerings of oxen to the Lord. And Moses took half of the blood and put it in basins, and half of the blood he threw against the altar. Then he took the book of the covenant and read it in the hearing of the people. And they said, all that the Lord has spoken we will do, and we will be obedient. And Moses took the blood and threw it on the people and said, behold, the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words. Then Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel went up, and they saw the God of Israel. There was under his feet, as it were, a pavement of sapphire stone, like the very heaven for clearness. And he did not lay his hand on the chief men of the people of Israel. They beheld God and ate and drank. Then the Lord said to Moses, come up to me on the mountain and wait there, that I may give you the tablets of stone with the law and the commandment, which I have written for their instruction. So Moses rose with his assistant Joshua, and Moses went up into the mountain of God. And he said to the elders, wait here for us until we return to you. Behold, Aaron and Hur are with you. Whoever has a dispute, let him go to them. Then Moses went up on the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. The glory of the Lord dwelt on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days. And on the seventh day, he called to Moses out of the midst of the cloud. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the sight of the people of Israel. Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain. And Moses was on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights.
I wish you could have met my father. I brag on him all the time. He was not a perfect man, but I have so many great memories of him. And one of them was going to church. He loved worship. Now, he's an oil field mechanic. He was a jailhouse singer. That means that he was always behind a few bars and he lost a key. But he loved to sing. Sunday mornings were his favorite time. He was a redeemed man. He was a redeemed man. And I can remember, even as a youngster, on Sunday mornings, hearing him sing the old rugged cross as he was shaving and saying, okay, boys, We get to go to church. And off we would go. And he always sat as close to the front as he could get. And he sang as loudly as he could. Now, if you're a 6 or 7 year old boy and you idolize your dad, don't you know how impressionable those kids are? And I know I was blessed. But parents, let's do the same for our kids. Let's do the same, grandparents, for our grandkids. Let's do the same, church, for one another. Worship is contagious. It's contagious. In fact, when unbelievers see believers worshiping, they're, wow, what's going on here? That's what Paul said. Paul said that worship, he urged us to worship in such a way that if an unbeliever walked in, he would find the secrets of his heart revealed, and he would fall down on his face and worship God, declaring that God is indeed among you. David said the same thing. David said, he put a new song in my mouth and a song of praise to our God. And many people will see this and worship him. They will trust the Lord. Oh, the power of worship. The power of worship. Transformation. It changes our face. Proclamation. It gives us a chance to declare what we believe so we can seek it with preparation. Preparing our hearts. And who knows? When we see the pilot, we might leave with a set of wings. Thank you, Lord, for the promise and message of worship.
So now, Jesus takes his disciples. He goes up to this mountain. And while on that mountain, verse 2, he was transfigured before them. And his face shone like the sun. And his clothes became white as light. Behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. And Peter said to Jesus, Lord, it's good that we're here. If you wish, I'll make 3 tents here, one for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah. He was still speaking them. Behold, watch, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And a voice from the cloud said, this is my beloved son with whom I'm well pleased. Listen to him. Isn't it powerful? In the Old Testament, they can't foresee this moment with Jesus. They go up to this mountain. Moses is there. The cloud is there. The glory of God. They are just in awe of this moment. God gives them the law, the covenant. They say, we'll do all these things. And now in this moment with Jesus, his kingdom is coming. He takes his disciples up and that cloud is there. They get to stand in the midst of the story now with Moses and Elijah and Jesus. And the Father says, now listen to him. Listen to my son. Do you know Peter talks about this moment? Jesus says, don't tell anybody. Don't tell anybody until I've risen from the dead. Don't do that. Don't tell anybody. But Peter did actually talk about this moment. So I want you to go to your Bibles now to 2 Peter 1. Listen to what Peter says about it. 2 Peter, near the end of your Old Testament, chapter 1. I'm actually going to read a little further above, and that's in verse 14. No, 13. Okay, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 13. Here's what Peter says. This is near the end of his life. I think it is right, as long as I am in this body, to stir you up by way of reminder, since I know that the putting off of my body will be soon, as our Lord Jesus Christ made clear to me. You know where that was? If you read the end of the Gospel of John, just mark it down, read the last chapter of the Gospel of John, and you see the interaction between Jesus and John and Peter, and it's a prophecy of Jesus there at the end of the gospel according to John, where Jesus tells Peter that he's going to be martyred. He's going to die for his faith in Jesus. He just reconciles Peter to himself, and then he tells him that when he is older, someone's going to take him where he doesn't want to go. He's going to die as a martyr. And of course, Peter in that moment looks over to the other disciple and he says, what about him? He goes, what about him? And Jesus says, watch, this is big. It goes along with everything I'm saying in terms of the imminent judgment in the first century church and generation. Jesus says to Peter, when he tells him he's going to die, and then Peter says, what about John? He says, if I will that he remains until I come, what is that to you? You follow me. If I will that he lives until I return, what? In judgment. What's that to you? What business is that of yours, Peter? You follow me. That's another example, by the way, of the fact that Jesus was clearly telling his disciples that he was returning in that generation to judge. If I want John to be around until I come back to judge, that's none of your business, Peter. You follow me. By the way, do you know who the only disciple was? This is awesome. It's awesome. Do you know who the only disciple was to live through the destruction of Jerusalem and die of his old age? Do you know the only one to survive all of that? It was John. He did live to see Christ come back in judgment on that generation. All the other apostles, they all died. John survived. And we know from history, John actually did take care of Jesus' mother, Mary, and he buried her in Ephesus. John survived. Nero tried to kill him. He failed. He sent John into exile to Patmos. That's another sermon to give. But here we go. Here's Peter, verse 16. He says, I know I'm about to die. Verse 16, we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were, here it is, eyewitnesses of his majesty. For when he received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to him by the majestic glory, this is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased. We ourselves heard this very voice born from heaven, for we were with him on the holy mountain. And we have something more sure, the prophetic word to which you will do well to pay attention as to a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. See that? That's Peter now talking about that experience on the mountain. He says this about Jesus. We were eyewitnesses to his majesty. You see, what's amazing about the life and ministry of Jesus is that none of this is private revelation. Watch. What's the law of God say concerning accusations or claims being made? Receive no accusation against an elder unless it's on the basis of what? 2 to 3 witnesses. What's the law of God in terms of confirming something? What is it? 2 to 3 witnesses. What did Jesus bring up with him on that mountain? 3 witnesses. Jesus brought the witnesses, and Peter's saying this. This isn't a fable. This isn't a myth. I'm not telling you tales out of the schoolyard. I was an eyewitness to Jesus. I saw his glory, and I heard that voice speak from heaven. I was an eyewitness to his majesty. Peter is telling you that story later on in his life before he's killed. He said, I saw him. I saw Jesus in his glory. And there's something about this moment that's just so peculiar. You know what it is? Because the life of Jesus, throughout his ministry, there's so much happening in the ministry of Jesus that tries to, well, I don't want to say try. It displays his humanity. So, for example, Jesus bled, right? Jesus got hungry. Jesus was beaten up. Jesus had his beard pulled from his face. They smashed a crown of thorns into his head. And I want to say this, that hurt. Jesus, because he's God in the flesh, it didn't mean that his humanity was somehow diminished and he didn't feel that pain. The abuse was less for Jesus. When Jesus was a little boy, I imagine that Jesus got stomach aches. I imagine when Jesus hit puberty, Jesus got pimples. See, we don't think about that often, do we? Because we see Jesus is God. But you know what? It's always emphasized through and through that Jesus is a perfect representative for you because he's truly human, fully human. Jesus had chosen to have limitations, limitations that humanity offers. Jesus was God and man. But here's a shining moment in the ministry of Jesus. Up on this high mountain, the glory cloud of God, the law and the prophets and the Father shouting from heaven, this is the Son of my love. I'm pleased with him. You listen to him. But this is a moment where heaven is opened and you see the glory of the Son of Man shining through. You see, Paul talks about it in Philippians chapter 2. You read it later. Paul talks about the nature of God taking on flesh. He said, Jesus, who is in the very form of God, did not consider equality with God a thing to be grasped or held on to. But what did he do? He emptied himself. And he took upon the form of a servant. And he was obedient even unto death. And it's amazing because it's so complex, I don't understand it fully. None of us can. The complexity of the incarnation, God, fully God, eternally God, omnipresent, full of wisdom, truth, power, justice, no sin, entering into our experience and coming into a mother's womb, being dependent upon breast milk. I don't get it. It's incomprehensible. God as a man, as a baby, held in his mother's arms. Mary being cautious not to drop Jesus. Mary being super cautious to keep an eye on Jesus' eating habits, right? Are you eating enough? Have I fed him enough, right? Because this is not somebody who's walking down the streets of Jerusalem glowing because he's fully God and yet fully man. And in this moment, in the transfiguration, up on that mountain, here's this shining moment of the law and the prophets and the Father and pointing to Jesus, and then heaven splits for a second, earth splits, and you see, this is who you're contending with. This is the majesty that really exists with Jesus. And it's super terrifying, if you think about it, because all through Jesus' ministry, his life and ministry, not everyone got to see this glorious moment where earth and heaven open up, and the glory of Jesus shines through. So you've got people challenging Jesus. Can you imagine if they had known that all God has to do is open up the heavens for a moment and they would have been on their faces, tearing their clothes, throwing sackcloth and ash. If they had known who they were dealing with, people who beat Jesus, people who argued with Jesus, people who are trying to get Jesus turned over to the authorities, they had no idea what they were doing. But the glory of the incarnation is that this God, he humbled himself, he walks among us. And this is, I gotta tell you, that when I was preparing for this message, honestly, I had this moment, this real profound moment, and I don't know why it was so profound, I'm still trying to think about it. But I had this profound moment where as I'm reading this text, I'm thinking about how am I gonna present this, and I'm praying through it, and I'm trying to figure it out to be a blessing to the church. The thing that got me the most this week, all of it's amazing. The thing that got me most is this moment where they are so terrified, so legitimately terrified, where all this stuff breaks open and they're just trying to figure out how to manage it. And they're saying, we'll build something for him and you. And then the Father speaks from heaven and their response is absolute fear. They are so terrified that they're falling on their faces. They are so scared of this moment. And I love what Jesus does. This is what got me. Jesus comes over and it says, they fell on their faces and were terrified, but Jesus came and touched them, saying, rise and have no fear. Isn't it amazing that these are human beings who are sinners before God. They hear the voice of the Father, and they are so terrified. That's the voice of their Creator. They know who they are. They know who He is. And their first response to hearing the Father's voice is to actually fall on their face in fear. And I love what Jesus does for His people who are afraid of the voice of their Father. He comes and He watches. He touches them. I encourage you to study the ministry of the touch of Jesus all throughout the Gospels. Jesus doesn't just stand to the side and talk to people. He comes up and he touches them. Jesus walks up to the disciples who are terrified of the voice of their Father. He puts his hands on them and he says what to them? He says, get up. You don't have anything to be afraid of. You see, because we don't just have the law and the prophets, but we have Jesus. Now watch, there is no fear between the Father and us. There's no reason for you and I, as followers of Jesus, to have, watch, an unhealthy fear of the Father, a terrified fear of the Father. Jesus stands between us and the Father. He puts his hand on us and he says, you don't have to be afraid anymore. Why? Because I'm here. It's not just the law and the prophets, it's Jesus. Don't be afraid anymore. Jesus establishes, watch, a new way between us and the Father. Isn't it amazing? It's a powerful thought. Now I want to just finish here by talking about a couple things, and then we're going to do our baptisms. Peter thinks that he, Jesus, is to be honored like the other prophets. He's to be honored like the other prophets. And what he learns from the Father is that when they're dealing with Jesus, they're dealing with something wholly new. I just want to point you to this passage. You don't have to go to it. I just want to read it for you. In Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 15, this is a prophecy about the one who's coming. It says, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me," that's Moses, "from among you, from your brothers. It is to him you shall listen." Now, isn't it amazing? In the Old Testament, Moses actually says, God's going to raise up a prophet like me from among you, and you are to listen to him. They get up on top of this mountain. Moses is there. The Father says, here he is, the one who I've raised up out of the people just like you. Listen to him. It's a fulfillment of that prophecy in Deuteronomy 18, 15. Listen to the coming prophet, the one who now has arrived. Moses and Elijah are not irrelevant. This would be a wrong way to read this passage. Well, God says, no, you listen to Jesus now, so you don't need Moses and Elijah. You don't need the prophets. That's not what God is saying here. It's not that they are now irrelevant. It's that Christ is the peak from which we're to view everything else. Now, it says, verse 9, as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus commanded them, tell no one the vision until the Son of Man is raised from the dead. That's a prophecy of his death and his resurrection, and it happened. And the disciples asked him, then why do the scribes say that first Elijah must come? He answered, Elijah does come, and he'll restore all things. But I tell you that Elijah has already come. And they did not recognize him, but did to him whatever they pleased. So also the Son of Man will certainly suffer at their hands. Then the disciples understood that he was speaking to them of John the Baptist. I want to summarize this by saying, I think this passage is incredible testimony to the faithfulness of God that he keeps his promises. Just consider, Moses and Elijah were constantly foreshadowing and foretelling the story of Jesus. It's all pointing forward to Jesus as the ultimate. The Old Testament is giving direct prophecy. For example, Deuteronomy 18, the Lord your God will raise up a prophet like me from among your brothers. You shall listen to him. That's one prophecy amongst so many. Direct prophecy. Jesus is coming. God keeps his covenant promises. Oh yeah, Elijah's supposed to come first. Jesus says he did. And they did to him whatever they wanted. It was John the Baptist. Just like it was foretold, he showed up. He will restore all things. And just like that Old Testament prophecy said, Elijah comes first, forerunner, then Jesus, then covenant, judgment, and redemption. It all happened just like God said. Everything taking place throughout our Bibles is yes and amen. All of God's promises, all of his prophecies. And not only watch in this moment, do you have all these prophecies fulfilled in this one moment on a mountaintop and the glory of God shining through, but you also have Jesus once again testifying, I'm going to suffer, I'm going to die, I'm going to rise from the dead. They could not completely understand that, but everything Jesus said happened. God said the forerunner is going to come, Messiah is going to come, then they will be judged and redemption will follow. It all happened in the first century. Jesus says, I'm going to die and rise again. It all happened. So I want to end with this point. When you read a text like Matthew chapter 17 about the transfiguration, it's this swirl of pattern predictions fulfilled in this moment on top of a mountain. It's this swirl of specific prophecies predicted. Jesus fulfills them. And then more promises are being made. But I think the powerful thing to think about is that with Jesus, with his entrance into the world, he changes the nature of our relationship with the Father to remove our sin, to remove our fear, to bring us into an entirely new way with God. And all of his promises are sure and guaranteed and yes and amen, and there's no question. So when I read this text, I think about God's faithfulness throughout time. And I think about my unfaithfulness. And I think about my inconsistencies. And I think about my failures as a follower of Jesus. I think about my failures as a father, as a husband, as a human being. I think about my sins and my inconsistencies. And I'm reminded in a moment like this on a mountaintop with Jesus that God doesn't have the same problems that I do. God is faithful to his covenant promises. God is faithful to all of his promises. When God says something's going to happen, it happens. Nothing can alter it. And there are times where I hear something from God, watch, and I think, wow, that's amazing. And I can tell in this passage, we don't understand the half of it. It is so much bigger and more glorious. And if we could just have heaven and earth split for just a moment, we would see that it's more than we ever thought it was. And it would change us. So my question to you is this. How do you respond to this moment in history that Peter says he was an eyewitness to his majesty? How do you respond to it? Is it just an amazing story? Is that it? Is it just an awesome moment in history that shows how awesome Jesus is? Or are there things connected to this story that do relate to you very personally and intimately in your relationship with the Father? Can I ask you, are you in that place where you hear the Father's voice and you're still in fear and trembling on the ground? Or can you hear the voice of Jesus? Can you feel his touch where he says, you don't have to be afraid? Do you think God is like you? Half-fulfilled promises, inconsistency, jaded, indifferent? Or do you see in a moment like this that God is actually the faithful one? He is the sure foundation. He keeps his word, and he is intimately involved in everything that is going on here. Can you see in this moment that God hasn't forgot his promises, that he keeps them? Can you see in this moment that God isn't like you? And so here's the call. God says that Jesus is returning to judge the living and the dead. God says that he's going to redeem and restore the world. God says, watch, whoever has the Son has the life. Whoever does not have the Son does not have the life, but the wrath of God abides in him. How do you respond to that? Will you repent and believe in the good news? Will you come to the Father through the Son and receive the Father's love and blessing and salvation and redemption? How will you respond to this message of God? Because here's the thing. Peter actually had a word from God. It's kind of powerful. He had a word from God. Peter, you're going to die a martyr's death. So Peter even tells you, I'm coming to the end here, guys. I know I'm about to be killed. He knew it. He knew he had some time, but he knew he was going to be martyred. You and I don't know that we have tonight or tomorrow morning or this week. You and I don't know how much time we have given to us by God to live in the world that he's created. So here's the question. What will you do with Jesus? Because you see, what's amazing is in this moment, the disciples of Jesus, those who knew God and were saved by Jesus, these guys had every reason to be told by Jesus, do not be afraid. Why? Because Jesus is standing between us and the Father. That's why they had no reason to be afraid. But let me just say, if you face God in eternity, if you stand before God without Christ as your mediator, if you stand before God without him standing between you and the Father as an intercessor, then that majesty and glory will be something to be afraid of. That majesty and glory will be terrifying and not a delight. If you don't have Christ, then when you hear the Father's voice, you have everything to be afraid of. Because you'll then meet God not as Savior and friend and lover of your soul. You'll meet God as judge. You'll meet God as perfect judge who will always do right. And so here's the question. Will you come to Christ, the glorious one, the God-man who loves and saves his people? Will you come to him to trust in him and his work? Or will you continue to turn the other way? And for my brothers and sisters in here, who have found yourself in a pattern of sin. You found yourself in a pattern of indifference. You found yourself in a pattern of honestly feeling like giving up. Maybe you find yourself after 20 years of being in Christ, still struggling with the same things, feeling this is about as far as you can go in your relationship with God because I'm not changing. Maybe God's going to leave me the way that I am. Will you see that God is faithful? And when he makes promises to change you and to be there for you and to embrace you and to fill you and to empower you, that is a promise that you can keep. It's as sure and as amen as every promise that led to the transfiguration. So what will you do with God's promises? Will you embrace them? Will you rejoice in them? Or will you be indifferent?